There's a difference between trust and abdicating.
Hello and welcome to the Business of Architecture. This week I am speaking with Hugh Glazer, who is a CPA for 30 plus years, and he delivers CFO and business operations services to private companies and not-for-profit organizations. As a consultant and part-time CFO and hands-on advisor, Hugh strategically manages projects to offer merger, acquisition integration, budgeting, financial planning, and managing new initiatives to deliver dramatic results. Hugh has mentored over 150 plus CEOs through the 10,000 Small Business Program at Babson College. His specialties include software development, publishing, architecture, advertising, and not-for-profit. And he is also our specialist financial consultant inside of the Smart Practice Method. Because of his extensive experience working with architecture, engineering, and construction businesses, and he has been a what you might call a fractional CFO to many architecture practices, and he's been working with us at Business of Architecture in the Smart Practice Method, helping architects become more profitable and more impactful. So in this week's episode, we are discussing some key financial metrics that every architecture practice needs to get a handle on and should be observing. We talk about profit and target multipliers. We talk about cash flow and cash flow break even. We talk about net fee per staff. We talk about utilization rates, checks and balances, and of course, accounts receivable. So this is going to be a whirlwind of information. It's a really, really powerful conversation, and is an essential listening to any architecture practice who's looking to get serious about their profit. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Hugh Glazer.
Hey, Enoch Sears here from Business of Architecture. And if you run an architectural practice, then probably one of the most difficult parts about running your practice is making sure you get your fees right, getting the right fee for the job. Because if you undercharge, ultimately, as you know, what ends up happening is you get to the end of the fee and there's still more job left. In that case, you're juggling to try to rob Peter to pay Paul, stealing from a more profitable project to support the less profitable projects. And on the flip side, you probably don't want to charge your clients absorbently too much than you actually need to get the project done. So the question is, how do you charge the right fee? Well, one resource that's been lacking in the architecture industry for a long time now is some sort of guide or comparison about what architecture firms actually charge. If you try to run a Google search on it, what do architects charge? You'll find some outdated information that's wildly inaccurate. And so I just want to record this quick little video to let you know and get to, so you can look forward to something that we're doing here at Business of Architecture, which is we will be launching a comprehensive fee report talking about and just revealing what architectural practices around the United States and elsewhere are actually charging, how they set their fees. Do they do percentage of construction cost? Is it stipulated sum? Is it hourly not to exceed? Also, what are the particular amounts? We're really excited about this because ever since we started, founded Business of Architecture over 10 years ago, this has been a common question is like, is my pricing right? Is my pricing right? And so this is the question that we hope to answer when we release in December, we'll be releasing this fee report. Now, one of the advantages is of us as a consulting agency is that we can put out this kind of information. Unfortunately, as you know, if you're in the United States, a couple decades ago, the AIA got into big trouble because they published a list of basically like a fee chart, right? So like a fee matrix. And then the United States Justice Department decided that that was price fixing. It was causing a monopoly. And so they got in big trouble for doing that. Well, fortunately, from our perspective, we're not limited to talk about fees because we're not an organization. We're not a membership organization. We don't represent architecture as a whole. We're simply a consultancy. And as a matter of fact, our job and our business is to help architectural practices to succeed. So this is why we're super excited about this. So this is just a heads up. Make sure you keep your eyes out on your inbox. If you're not already on our email list, head over to businessofarchitecture.com. Make sure you sign up for our free live video training, and then you'll automatically get put onto our email list. So you will be the first to be notified when we release the fee and compensation report. All right. This is specifically tailored for you if you're a small architectural practice owner. You'll get to see very clearly what other people of similar size firms, similar size demographics, similar typologies are actually charging, how they set their fees. So you can start to answer that big question is, I wonder how I fit into what my competitors are charging.
This podcast is produced by Business of Architecture, a leading business consultancy for architects and design professionals. This episode is sponsored by Smart Practice, Business of Architecture's flagship program to help you structure your firm for freedom, fulfillment, and financial profit. If you want access for our free training on how to do this, please visit smartpracticemethod.com. Or if you want to speak directly to one of our advisors about how he might be able to help you, please follow the link in the information.
Hugh, welcome to the Business of Architecture. How are you?
Very good, Ryan. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Always good to be speaking with you. You are, we've been working together for the last year or so.
Just about, yes.
You're one of our trusted advisors here at Business of Architecture. You've got an incredible amount of experience as a CFO, a kind of fractional CFO or CFO for hire. And you'll go into architecture businesses, engineering firms, anything in the AEC space, and help them with their financial awareness, their metrics, their target setting, parts of their accounting. And you're very much bringing that CFO, that chief financial officer expertise into a business for companies that perhaps aren't large enough to have their own C-level executive suite. So very good to be speaking with you. And I guess, first of all, how did you get into that role? How come architects, engineers, construction industry, how did that begin?
It isn't, Ryan, necessarily that it was a grand plan, but one of the themes of my working career and background is that I've always tended to work with what I describe as creative people doing creative things. Early in my career, I worked with publishing companies, both in the direct or traditional print arena, as well as the early stages of digital publishing, including when we thought CD-ROM was the big breakthrough because it was cheaper than being online. And then I worked, that leveraged me into where I spent several years consulting, working with a consulting firm that specialized in working with advertising and public relations firms. And back in my sort of the connection to architecture and engineering is came back in my original training as a CPA. I worked for an accounting firm that had a large presence with architecture firms. And then later going back, must be getting closer to 20 years ago than yesterday, I happened to do a project for a former partner of that firm that was then the CFO of a very large 500 person, I think 18 office international architecture firm. And that, hey, can you come help me for 3 weeks, turned out to be a two-year project, and that got me reestablished. And since that point in time, just by very much the kismet or Camelot of being in the right place at the right time, led me to continue to work with more and more architecture firms. And pretty much now, for close to the last 10 to 15 years, architects and affiliated engineering firms have been almost my exclusive practice area. I do some other things, like I'm also an arbitrator with the American Arbitration Association. I've been a business advisor in the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses Program, which is a wonderful, just like we do here in the Business of Architecture, boot camp kind of training for entrepreneurs and principals. And it's really, like I said, I that creative people doing creative things. I really enjoy the challenge of helping architects, because people have gone to become trained as an architect because there's something about design and creation that appeals to them, and they're not the idea of, whoa, success is now we have 5 employees, 10 employees. Now you have business issues that are a vital part of keeping the practice flourishing, but weren't for the most part part of your professional training. And that's, I think, the thing of what we're trying to do here through the Business of Architecture and the Smart Practice Program is to help folks strengthen up that other part of their foundation, so to speak.
In your experience, what have been some of the reoccurring trends that you've seen common to lots of architecture practices with their financial awareness?
I think some of it starts from just as I was saying, because professional schools of any discipline other than perhaps a business discipline don't teach their graduates the mechanics of how to, you know, run the business side of their profession. So we're all kind of coming in with that as a deficit. And I think because it's not the natural place with architects are sensitive to, they don't have an appreciation of what the investment is. So I think the common theme is there's an underinvestment in administrative support and financial operations specifically, and that has to do, you know, bookkeeping, accounting, software. Oh my, something in law can do it a couple hours a week or something like that. And really, you know, when you think about it, it's become a very rich and heavily driven technology profession, you know, with AutoCAD, Revit, BIM tools, specification tools. And so we're all understand how those need to be updated and kept current, but nobody thinks about we have to make similar kinds of investments in our accounting system and our accounting staff. We need folks as you start to grow that are as knowledgeable in internal or in bookkeeping as we have people that do drawing. So,
is there a different set of issues that you see with smaller businesses as opposed to what you see with larger businesses? Or do some of those issues kind of...
Well, they're very similar generally. You know, you want to keep an eye on things. You want to have a check and balance. I think that's another thing actually that comes to me. You ask a question that people don't think about it is checks and balances. Nobody should be doing anything or executing any set of tasks or responsibility without somebody overseeing that. And that includes when I work, folks. I want partners, shareholders that ask questions. I mean, it's wonderful if you have trust and confidence in me or your other advisor, but don't just give us the keys and go away. I mean, this is something that's actually come an interesting project I'm doing now where for a larger firm where the CFO is retiring. And this is a person that's been there 25 plus years and has done everything. And now that person is stepping away. So the other principals now haven't had to participate in any of the check and balance. And I'm saying, well, okay, I can help you. You know, this is a normal thing, happens with anybody. It'll be traumatic briefly for everybody because it's a big change. But here's things you need to do in your fiduciary role of managing the business and finances. And it's like, well, wait a minute. I don't like that. Or I don't know how, maybe what comes from, I don't know how to do that. So some of this is also, there's getting the task done. And then as a principal and owner, you also need to understand what your check and balance or fiduciary role is as well. And that's equally as important as having a competent bookkeeper or accountant.
Yeah. This might sound silly, but would you say that that many architects actually haven't made the link between perhaps some of the struggles and challenges that they're experiencing in their business with the lack of investment in their you know, financial awareness or financial operations?
I think that's, I probably couldn't have said it better myself. I think you're exactly right on.
And
I think it's not off until people come into a program like a BO, like the Smart Practice from that, and they see and they go, whoa, wait a minute. How come, you know, then they learn, and then it can get to be a little overwhelming too when you go, whoa, here's all these things going. This is my business. I've built it. It's either whether you're a solo person or you have a couple of partners, and all of a sudden you go, whoa, you know, you get maybe a little scared of what could have happened too.
Yeah.
But definitely, there's an awareness that isn't there because it's not your background as an architect. And I think that's why these kinds of programs are very important, because it isn't that hard. Once you see what it is, it's not that hard. It's just to have perspective of, you know, it's just like with a personal checking account. If you never look at your own bank statement, how do you know about the five checks you forgot to, you wrote that you forgot to write down? You know, those kinds of things.
It's very interesting that these kind of symptoms, if you like, of poor financial management might be, you know, overwhelm, the experience of being the bottleneck in the business, always, you know, kind of everyone working late nights, and they're still never being, you know, I mean, the amount of times we've spoken to clients and, you know, profit, what's profit?
Right, or
celebrating at breaking even. Hooray, broken even.
One of the other companion things about it is bookkeeping and accounting for an architectural practice isn't complicated in the sense of, you know, we like to always use the expression, it's not rocket science. It's not that level of complication, but there is a complexity that's different to it than most other kinds of non-professional services business. And the simple part of that is this notion is every time, you know, for the most part, every billing or income transaction is theoretically related to a time charge, you know, without getting into types of fees, but as a base level. But every time an hour of time is worked, there's a fee income related component to it, and there's a cost payroll related component to it. And that is, again, it's not, you know, rocket science, but it is more complex than many other businesses, because these things have to go on in parallel together, and not you know, you can have some very good bookkeeper level folks that if they're not experienced with that, it takes a little while for them to get trained and appreciate the nuances of that.
Well, it's often quite interesting when we speak to architects that, you know, from a business perspective, putting your profit margins first, and here's what we're going to set, and here's the profit that we want to take out of the project, and then we work backwards. And all right, if you use the rule of thirds, for example, a third of it's going to go for the profits, a third of it's going to be on the overhead, and a third of it is going to be on the salary of the team. That salary can then be translated into hours. And then we've got at least some sort of mechanism at play to be able to distribute the hours to the team so they know what's going to happen. But that often, it's not spoken about. It doesn't happen. The profit margins are not there. They are left to chance.
Well, no, that's very much, these are the things we've talked about in some of our sessions, monthly sessions with the group, is that at the starting point, you ought to have an understanding of what profit or you want to get out of this. You're putting a lot of effort into it. You've got a lot of time. As you're building a team, you've got the resources and dependencies of the families of your team. If you have your personal assets, you know, involved with guaranteeing the finances of the company, so it's very important. Hey, we're doing all this, you know, what do I hope to get out of it? So you can compare that on whether that responsibility and load, as well as satisfaction of having your own business, is better than going to work for somebody else and you get a paycheck and you go home at night and you're fine. And I think, so that's why the approach I always like to say, and you touched on it a little, is sit down and the first place you start is with your team. This is what our payroll is for the year. This is what our operating expenses are, and I want to have a profit or a return on top of that. And now all of a sudden we've talked about the capacity planning spreadsheet is one of the tools that we give folks, is that you say, okay, I need to generate this amount of fee to hit my target, and that everything falls from there. So you really, and it is truly a sense of that old cliche that having no plan is a plan for failure or something like that. So you have to have a map, or otherwise you're kind of just wandering around and going from one project to another. And I think as part of that capacity driven exercise that, as Ryan was talking about, the rule of threes, you know, the first third is your payroll cost. Your next third is all the other non-payroll expenses. And then that last third is your profit margin. And they're all very important components. And along with that, after you have some history, and there are a few exceptions to what I'm about to say, I believe that every firm should have a minimum fee. Where in the context of, you say, okay, if any work that we take on, if we can't get X, and I'll just pick, say, $5,000 because for the purpose of the exercise, if we can't get a fee of at least $5,000, we're not going to make any money. So you could casually say, what's the point of taking the work? However, I always have a, you know, these are rules and guidelines and not 100% certain. You know, the exceptions to the minimum fee are, this is a very good client. We can't say no. We don't want to say no. This is an area where we don't have a lot of expertise, but we want to continue to build our portfolio. Or it's a combination of the above, and particularly it's with a new client, and this is potentially get us in the our foot in the door for a bigger work. But and these things sometimes can happen by kismet or catch as catch can, but you need to have, you know, science to it. And I think also to the extent that some of our firms may be owned by baby boomers, you know, where we also need to be thinking about succession. And a lot of these things that you and the current and the founding partners that are intuitive, you need to start figuring out a training program for your successors so that the next generation develops their own intuition and they don't, and you're going to give them the benefit of your experience and the value. So these are, it's very important to have planning on the on these topics and revisit them with a frequency of no less often than once a year. I think some of these things would merit reviewing every 6 months, depending on what's happening with your year or even every quarter. Some of them ought to be refreshed. Yeah, check the plan. Are we tracking the way we want it? And if everything seems aligned and pointing in the right direction, you don't have to spend a lot of time with it. If you've got a big divergence, I think it's at your own best interest to jump on that as soon as possible and understand whether it's because it's just circumstances of the economy have changed or whether some of the assumptions you made didn't play out about what was going to happen and what, depending on what kinds of marketplaces your clients are in, or we just sometimes make a bad guess, and that's okay too. And one of the things as part of that, I always recommend, we talk about, and we're going to talk a little later today too, I think about some metrics about what should I be looking at. What I often tell folks is you should have a deep understanding of what business your clients are in, because we're in the service of other clients. So if you deal with restaurants, if you deal with hotels, retail, you should have, and you have high concentrations, you should be watching what's happening in the economic forecast of those industries. In many ways, that those kinds of statistics and awareness as are equally, if not more important than some of the metrics we're going to talk about managing your architecture firm.
That's very interesting. That's very, very interesting. And certainly in terms of being able to deliver more value to clients. And this is certainly something that will, you know, often go missed by lots of different service professionals, is actually understanding what the financial story is for your client. What's their business agenda? And then being able to align your services with that, because that ultimately creates an enormous amount of value when your value proposition is directed very clearly with a deep understanding of the financial story that's happening with the client.
And I think it's also to include an awareness of what's happening geographically. You know, if you have offices in different locations, different states, different parts of the country, different things can be going on. And then I always I don't want to say too much that's going to date stamp the time we're recording this, but we're in this period of time where there's a lot of concern about inflation and whatnot. And I often get concerned that we have all these public pundits that aren't actually in companies telling the rest of us what's going on, where I think it's also good just to keep a pulse of what you see, I think is almost often more important than what the pundits are saying. And I think it's always good to reach out to your, you know, if you can't do all, but your major clients periodically during the year, just to stay connected, pick their mind. I mean, I'm talking to, one of the things I love about what I do is I'm talking to perhaps on any given week, a dozen or so people from not only architecture, but in other businesses across the country. And it gives you a different sense of, you know, other than what you see out your own windows. I think it's always important to be checking, looking, assessing, and measuring. And you don't give everything equal weight, but, you know, you try to balance it sort of like in the jigsaw puzzle of how you run your firm and things on a week-to-week basis.
Brilliant. Let's start talking about then some of the key financial metrics that a business and architecture practice should be looking at. And we've kind of touched on one already around profit. And I've always enjoyed when we've had our group sessions and, you know, we might ask the group, how's everyone getting with their finance, you know, moving towards their financial targets. And, you know, a third of the room say, yeah, we're absolutely crushing it. Another third saying we're on track for it. And then another third might say, you know, we're nowhere near it. And you've responded in the past by saying, well, that's great because at least you know that right. You're nowhere near the target.
Right. Well, because you have a target, and that's a plan, and that's probably what we kind of said a little bit earlier in today's chat, is you have to have assessment. But if you don't have any measure, it's sort of like, I don't know, I've used this metaphor before, but what, you know, architects, design, measurement, you know, you're going to create a broad set of drawings with no legend or scale. You know, you need, just like you're building a structure, the plan is built in very similar ways, that we have certain protocols. And I think that, you know, on the metric, there's sort of two general sets of them. One are what I would call project performance. And that comes off of the things we were talking about, profit margin, billing multiples, so that you understand in that notion or the standard 3x that we've referred to already today, that's considered a multiple of three, because all multiples are generally driven as a factor of your payroll cost. So if I pay someone $10 an hour, a multiple of three means their billing rate is $30 an hour. So that's why I think it's important. One of the things that comes out of that capacity planning exercise and your target profit is you're going to have a target multiplier. So when you say, I want a $250,000 profit, you want to compare that to what your base payroll is. And that's going to give you this, I kind of skipped a step in there, but that's sort of the pathway to get your target multiple. So one of the things as you start going through the year and completing projects is you'll see what your actual multiple is against your target. And another thing that we'll talk about in a moment is your cash flow break even, and that leads you to a break even multiple. So that, you know, that this notion, I'm very big on cash management and cash planning. And then when I was talking about this cash flow break even is a version of, if we take back to the 3X, the payroll is the base, the second X is the operating expenses, and you add those together, that's sort of, in a way, our break even number. And I think it's important that you know that. So if your break even number every month is $100,000 and you don't generate at least $100,000 a month, you're going to lose money. So that break even target or cash flow break even is the 100, and then the cash for the break even multiple is that 100 against the payroll piece, so you know where you're going. And in graphing today, there's a lot of tools. Either you can put the data in Excel, or depending on what bookkeeping software you can, where you can be tracking this pretty much real time. And once you get the routine, you can see it as you go, and that's sort of the pathway from that. And other sort of income and project related statistics are net fee revenue per employee. That's something typically we measure on an annual basis, but you can start seeing how you're tracking, on a month-to-month basis. Mm-hmm. I think the other thing too that I'll just throw it out and we can come back to later. I think it's also important that after the completion of a project, it's not, sometimes we can't do all projects, but certainly projects of substance, there should be sort of a postmortem. Yes. Where you and the project team reviews how the numbers worked out. I think there's two pieces of it: is how did the work go? Did our estimates about hours and issues and come in, the way we hoped? And you got to have a system for keeping notes about that, so that the next time you have a project that kind of feels like it, sounds like it, you can go back and see what your experience is. But then also on the financial side, that you can see then what you learned about that would might help you the next time you go to set a fee on a project like that, or the next time you have to staff a project like that, of what kinds of resources in terms of, oftentimes we make the assumption or everybody's balancing, I can put a more expensive resource on something. And yep. I hope that because they got a higher skill level, they will get it done quicker, hopefully more accurate against a less junior person. But you have to be measuring that too. One of the things I learned from one of the gurus that I work with is that while we have a responsibility to give clients the best service possible, any given task doesn't have to be done by the most qualified person to do it. As long as we do it well and to the standard that we're required, that doesn't mean that the most experienced people are best deployed doing that. So that's something, that's a bigger kind of topic, but I always like to keep that in the background.
Well, that's quite interesting, because it kind of starts to feed in, when we're, some of the challenges of charging per hour, when we have extremely experienced architects, right, of 20 years plus. It takes them 15 minutes to do something, and then, but that 15 minutes is not the same, the right value there is, in particular from a client's perspective, if a client sees, oh, it took you 15 minutes to do that, then it's devalued in their eyes.
That's exactly how I refer to it, as value billing. And then that is very critical, particularly as you build experience in your team. Because having the expertise of how to do it is probably more important than the doing of it.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's very, very interesting. Some figures there. So just going back to the first one, then the target multiplier. This is a kind of a multiplier for your billing rate that's going to have inside of it built in a profit margin, a predetermined profit margin, and then a margin for your overheads. And the rule of thirds is a basic benchmark, business benchmark that many businesses.
Right. And that comes back, and also, so we give folks the right context that, our language about this always sounds like we're talking hourly in times and rates, but you have to use that exercise, because I think actually the predominant part of most of the architectural practices I work with do fixed fee work. But yeah, you have to go through that exercise to know what your investment is in order to set the fee. And that's where you leverage what Ryan was just talking about, the value of your expertise and your know-how. I mean, I have seen some situations with principals with experience generally know things that they bring it all down to a cost per foot, and it generally works. But you know, it's always good to understand that rather than just saying, oh, we can do that project for $5 a foot, but, you know, things change so fast today, you need to know that you, that the assumption that you got to the $5 is that your cost was $2, that circumstances didn't change, and now the cost is $3.50. So you have to always be, you know, instinct is wonderful, and I always tell folks I work with that no matter what, whether a kind of expert, whether it's me or someone else you work with, whoever tell you something that's instinctively doesn't sound right, the, you know, you should challenge it, but you always need to just be revalidating, your base thoughts, because there's lots of factors, and no one of us is can keep on top of all of them simultaneously all the time. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, great. So talking about cash flow then, how should businesses be looking at their cash flow, analyzing it? What kind of tools should they have?
So your cash flow, again, that comes out of this understanding of your operating a cost and your payroll and so forth. I like to use a format that I call a rolling 13-week cash flow. Early in my career, I did a lot of work with what was then called turnaround, tends to be companies that aren't necessarily bankrupt, but bankruptcy candidates potentially. So very much focus on cash on a day-to-day basis. And one of the tools I learned out of it was this rolling 13-week cash flow. And it's just like it sounds. You can take your Excel or Google spreadsheet and you run the dates 13 weeks across. And then you have your revenue at the top and then down to your expenses. And you map out what you anticipate has to happen in what weeks, and the key most common things are you've got your rent, which is monthly, payroll, and those kinds of things. And then you have to have a way of understanding when clients pay, which that, you know, gives you insight into your accounts receivable, which is another thing you should be on top of. And then what I usually do is show the preceding 4 to 5 weeks. So you have your history of what's happened, and you know, and again, reinforces not only billing, but collections, and so that, you know, nobody wants to wake up on the day that the bookkeeper is ready to submit payroll and say, guess what? We don't have money to cover it.
Absolutely. Not a situation we want.
Right.
Got it. Great. So let's look at this next ratio that you were discussing, the net fee per staff. What's that? What does it start to illuminate in a business?
Net fee?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, keep in mind that firms have different elements, but a lot of firms have pass-through costs, you know, whether it's marked up expenses, they use consultants that are either marked up or marked not. So a lot of times, the billing that goes out, the invoice value, some of it is already spoken for. You have to pay the consultants. You have to reimburse your employee expenses. So the concept of net fee income is the gross billing before these direct pass-throughs. And the net fee is taking the gross billing less those pass-throughs. So we get to a number, and that net fee is the money that's going to contribute the profit as well as paying the operating expenses. Because a lot of time, if you're going to do performance metrics against gross billing, it can lead you astray and give you false comfort that your operating expenses might look too low on a statistical basis. Yeah. And it's also generally inconsistent, because if you had a $50,000 consultant bill this month and you didn't have one next month, that gross number is going to be the same. But generally, that net fee income is what we're comparing against that cash flow break-even number. And you want, at least on a low side, to just be some consistency, that it doesn't go below, in a perfect world, it doesn't go below your cash flow break-even. And on the upside, we want it to be as high as above it all the time. So that's what the importance of the net fee income is, that you're not building your expense base on the pass-through items that are highly variable and change month to month.
Just in terms of languaging and labels, this is the same as a net operating revenue or similar.
Yes, yes. Or some firms call it net service income. Right. Yeah, as long as everybody understands it's not 100% of the dollars being billed to the client.
Got it. So it's minus the pass-throughs, minus the reimbursables. Got it. And so when we start looking at this net fee against the amount of full-time employees in the business, what is this starting to show? Why would a business be looking at this?
Well, that's where, and that's a good transition too, Ryan, that net fee. And when we talk about net revenue per FTE or employee full-time equivalent, if you're not familiar with the FTE, that's the number we want to divide. It's that net service, net income. And it gives you a sense of, because that's another, the architecture profession, there's lots of statistics, lots of surveys, and you have to know the relevance to where you are in your practice and how to best, what to measure. But that's a reasonably good one. And let's say, I think, typically, is the BOA, is that number about 130? Am I remembering that correctly?
It's 200 for excellent is the benchmark, 200 to 250 range, and then we've got the 150 is good, and then 100 is okay, and then below 100.
Yeah, yeah. All right. So let's say that, if on average 130, 150,000 a year per person. So when you add somebody, it gives you a sense of how to invest and build the firm. If your current program is you're in that range of the numbers that Ryan just threw out, you don't want to add somebody. That's a lot of overhead, particularly if it's an architectural services technical person, and have that drop by 25%. So the notion of it is, if you're going to add somebody, I need to be generating probably another 130,000 if that's my number. So it all ties back to the capacity planning, and that anytime, because right now we've been through a period of time where getting staff has been an extra challenge. People are overworked on teams, and it's instinctively we say, okay, we need more people because we can't keep burning our teams out. But you have to also be sure, if I add this person, I'm going to get a revenue increase. So that's the relevance of that. So that if you add two people, and it takes some time, layer them into your team and your program. But if in 18 months from now, we come back and we looked at your net revenue per employee, and that number isn't trending up, or at least holding its own to where you were before you added the person, we didn't execute the way we should have.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. This, as you know, we use this as a benchmarking number for all of our clients to kind of get a sense of where they're at. One thing to consider: what's the difference if we're looking at full-time equivalent employees versus, say, only the billable staff members?
I think that. When you're talking about the FTEs, it's you should be using everybody. And basically, the FTE metric comes from the presumption that 40 hours a week is the standard work week. So if you have two people that work 20 hours a week, effectively, that's one FTE. If you have someone that works 75% of 40 hours, then they would become 3/4. It just makes it a common, so we don't get, so we're measuring effort versus headcount, because everybody, even more and more today, people have a variable workforce. I think it's good to understand it because to keep the administrative people in the FTE number, because again, if you start diverting and you add three people for administrative purposes, and I'm not saying there isn't a time that wouldn't be appropriate, that you wouldn't see the load that's creating. So I'm a proponent of everybody, the FTE number for particularly purposes of net fee and revenue per employee should be an all-in FTE number.
Yeah, that makes sense, and that's what we've been doing here. I think what's very useful about that is that, you know, it does start to give a good performance ratio of the business, and as you're saying, it starts to certainly take into account the full-time equivalency, not just the headcount. So we'll often see principals and they put themselves down at one, and then we'll probe around and we'll say, how many hours are you working a week? Well, we're actually working an 80-hour week. Well, right. You're not one, you're now two. Right. And then that really can kind of sort of highlight the inefficiency of how many hours are being put into a project versus the performance.
Right, and I think the way that comes together is that the project team, everybody should have a target utilization rate. And that's the percentage of their work week that we anticipate that's going to be directly on projects versus overhead things like meetings or doing simple things like your timesheet and whatnot, that everybody on the project team has a utilization rate, and we have a way to measure against that. And that's how that issue where folks that might say, well, don't put them in the FTE number and the net revenue employee, it's the utilization performance that catches that. Because yes. Generally, overhead or administrative people have a zero utilization expectation, although I'm a proponent in some arenas that if you have a client that requires especially detailed billing, that the time of the person to do the bill, which is usually an admin person, that time should be charged to the project. And again, not necessarily that we're billing the time, but at least when we do our postmortem, we can say, okay, yeah, the service part of the work went through, but also, wow, managing these people have got some unique needs. Look at what the overhead admin team had to do to keep the client happy. That's not meaning it's a good or bad thing. It's an awareness. And just like you were saying before, it's important to be aware. The more information you're aware of, the better. It's the things that are happening that you don't have an opportunity to see that can catch up on you and sneak up, in the dark, so to speak.
With utilization rates, are there sort of benchmarks that a business should be aiming towards?
I think all these statistics and metrics are very personal because every firm that I've seen is very unique. But yes, I would think that non-ownership staff, and that would be, I don't want to start using tags like associate, because firms and principals use them differently. But I think that the people that are doing the work, when we can start from the entry level up to maybe the PM level, and some of this is also firm size, those folks, I think there's an expectation that their utilization ought to be in the 75, 80-ish range. I mean, that's one of the other things when we have people use the capacity planning tool, it gives you, we have a subsection that there's sort of a way to figure this out. So you, based on levels of service, how many hours of vacation, how many holiday, so you can start out coming up with a realistic utilization target. But I think generally, For non-senior folks, 75, 80 in certain circumstances is over the course of a year is reasonable. When you start getting into principals and shareholders, it starts to jump down because it depends on whether or not every principal has business development responsibilities. So the folks that are out landing work, it's a little different metric, and certainly I hope that those can be in the 50% range on the lower end. Now you have some organizations where there's principals that are almost 100% operational, and maybe they're down in the 20-25%. But the other thing, and actually I was just having a conversation with one of our folks the other day, just thinking about that when I'm talking with a firm that's a new relationship with me, and I start asking the senior people who does, you know, it's a whole list of standard operational things that a finance person would be interesting. And it, and the answer keeps coming back, I do that, or my partner does that. And I'm thinking, okay, you all are the most expensive people in the firm. Perhaps we can find a qualified, less expensive resource so you can go back to winning more work and growing the practice. So that may be, Ryan, going back to one of your first questions of common things that firms maybe struggle or need to try to have a plan to move away from sooner or later is doing all the bookkeeping yourself. There's some of these administrative tasks that it's good to know how to do it in the beginning. I'm a big fan of, I like to see how it works. And, you know, that way when I'm asking somebody to do that, they kind of understand that I'm not asking them to do something I'm not knowledgeable about myself, but that waiting too long to hire a bookkeeper, waiting too long to get in a, join a program like Smart Practice, those are some of the other things that if people can come to have that insight sooner rather than later, it's to their benefit. But some of that is having an awareness. You know, I think we all kind of suffer from sometimes we don't know what we don't know, and mm-hmm. and you don't want to learn that the hard way, so to speak. So,
yeah. I think it's very interesting there, you know, you're starting to point towards as well that where is your highest value activity as a principal in the business? And we can very quickly forget that, you know, there's lots of reasons why principals end up doing their own bookkeeping. I mean, I'm speaking to lots of people. There's trust. And sometimes this is one of these things that's either there's an insecurity around the numbers, or there's a lack of trust of letting anybody else, you know, have a look at them. So that information is kept very close to hands, are kept hidden, if you like, which then means that the principals are then using, you know, their hourly time doing work, which could, as you say, could be done much, much more efficiently with a less expensive resource. And it also starts to point to the illumination of, well, what are the most valuable activities for principals to be doing in the business? And obviously winning work is one, the strategic and planning activities, the financial planning and target setting and goal setting. And then underneath that might be some of the very high level design work. But again, we've got to be aware of, you know, for most principals, them getting stuck in and doing drafting is we can get somebody else to do that for a much lesser cost. And these are the sorts of things that start to skew the profit margins in the business.
Right. Yeah, something you said is also, I think, a very important reminder, Ryan, which home with the trust and back to what we were talking a little earlier today too, is that you have to have this. It's one thing to have, you have to have trust in the people that are working for you and the resources. And if you don't trust them, you should replace them. But there's a difference between trust and abdicating. And that was that something I referred to also earlier in today, that you don't have to be doing, but you have to have this check and balance. You have to have insight. One of the other things that I see in all kinds of smaller businesses, once you get that trusted bookkeeper, office manager, they're kind of left on their own. And they're, over time, what happens is the owner of the company or the principals are sometimes reluctant to ask the questions they ought to, either out of fear of annoying or irritating the person, or they don't want to true up and confess that they don't know the answer themselves. You know, there's an embarrassment element of it.
Yeah.
So I often say it's you get in these situations where the principals think their boss is the bookkeeper. And you should never be in that situation. And I think the other side of that too is you've got to, it's why it's an important to also have some other check and balance, whether it's your outside accounting firm or if you use a resource similar to what I provide, that you have somebody else that's overseeing the bookkeeper, because oftentimes bookkeeping inside accounting folks may be aware of certain issues that they think require attention, and they either don't have the confidence to bring it forward, or they have a fear that it may be reflect badly on them. So it's, you know, always, and it gets into thing of who writes and signs checks and things like that. So it's very important to have ongoing two-way conversation about what's happening, but that doesn't mean you need to live in the detail.
Yes.
Right.
And again, it's interesting on the other side of that. I'll speak to company bookkeepers, and they'll say, how do we get our principals to look at the books?
Yeah. Yeah. No. And another common thing I see a lot, and again, you know, the ownership of the company is, you know, almost always the most expensive talent in the company. And they're the worst at doing timesheets and some of the basic things that are important to keep the tracking going. So for those of you that don't walk the talk for your staff, I can tell you, if you think you're kidding, they don't know it, you're kidding yourself. So,
yeah. Absolutely. Again, I think you just mentioned their timesheets, and that this kind of comes as one of the absolute fundamentals of recording performance in a business, is to have a good grasp on.
Right. And the other counter to that is, well, we're doing fixed fee work. Why do we need the timesheet? Well, you don't necessarily need it, obviously, to do the billing. But we're trying to build a history of work effort against fees. And so far in my career, no one has shown me a better tool than timesheets, because we know what happened. And I think that, you know, keeping that on track is because that's our inventory. The value we're delivering is the effort of our teams. And the hours where we put the work is the best tool I know of understanding where our investment went. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Great. So to kind of finalize this, the balance sheet.
Yeah. So, we've been talking a lot about the income statement. Yeah, things on the balance sheet, obviously cash is the biggest one. You want to make sure your bank statements are reconciled every month, and they ought to be reviewed periodically by somebody other than the bookkeeper or accountant that did them. Another critical one is your accounts receivable, which is the tracking of the invoices that you sent to clients that haven't been paid yet. And if you don't have standard billing terms, let's say due in 30 days, and say that clearly on your invoices, you should. Now, I know that folks that deal with different government or municipal entities may have to agree to different payment terms, but you need to be aware of those and follow that up periodically. You know, this, you know, cliche here is the squeaky wheel. And I find that firms that are very proactive about following up invoices, especially now in this day and age that are 60 days old, they have their cash comes in on a more consistent basis. So you should never be just putting your client invoices out there and not doing any follow-up. And then the other companion piece is the accounts payable, is the money that you owe if you use consultants or your other rent, operating expenses, health insurance, and whatnot. So you always have a constant sense of who owes you and who do we owe. So that's the in and the out of that.
With the accounts receivable, now this is often an interesting one, and we've seen it with lots of our clients here. You've got your accounts receivable, then you've got your past due, and accounts that haven't been settled for long periods of time. This might be as a result of a lack of follow-up. Is there a healthy percentage that we should be looking at as a benchmark between those two? I mean, ideally it should be zero. There's no outstanding.
Well, yeah. I mean, and also keep in mind it's going to jump around. You got to be also cognizant of when you look at it. Like, for say, you know, we're coming out when we're recording this, we're in the last week of the month. So what's going to happen is next Monday, when we look at these aging reports, all of a sudden it's only going to be 3 or 4 days, but things could look dramatically poorer, because we just clicked over another cycle. And I think that, you know, my ideal world, you want to have, and if it isn't obvious, this aging or tracking report shows things by the time since the date of issue, you know, 0 to 30, 30 plus, 60 plus, and those are the traditional increments. But maybe for other firms, it could be a reason that your measurement periods are a different time range. But my ideal perspective is you should have 0 over 90. I mean, that's kind of unrealistic, but I think that once you have a patent and the way people do it, you really want to keep that as low as possible. I think there's times of the month where people are going to find that maybe 50, 60% of the receivables are going to be in that 45 to 80 days. But you want to work hard to kind of reduce that. There's lots of techniques. I think we talk about some of them in the program, retainers, pre-billing, flat billing, things to help balance that off. But I can tell you, somebody has to have the assignment of following these things up. But I like to try and encourage that as organizations get a little larger and perhaps you have multiple project managers, that should be one of the responsibilities of the project manager. They should be trained that asking to be paid is part of the job of the project manager. You know, we did the work, we delivered the service, we have a right to be paid. And we need to pay our employees and our consultants. So, Mr. Client, you know, you're 60 days past due. You got to help me out here. You know, and you got to, you know, I'm just paraphrasing, and you got to find your own style and approach for, because each client has different nuances, but, and I think that, like I said, that should be part of our training of what does it take to become, you know, a junior associate or an associate, that you're good at not only running the work, but some of these administrative tasks, like making sure we get paid. And I think over the past couple of years, we've started to kind of talk about different kinds of things that affect staff fatigue. And I think when we talk about client quality, this is one element of it. A client that we send the bill, they respect us, they pay on terms, that's a wonderful client. A client that, you know, the project manager or someone from accounting needs to constantly be checking on, hey, you haven't paid us, that's creating a different stress. And it's not perfect, but these are all sort of subtle things that, you know, drag our staff down, so to speak. When you say, what burns people out? It's, oh, I have to call them every month, you know. So these are things when you're making choices and go, no-go decisions and, you know, there's periodically, I think, where it's probably good to think about other clients we should fire because we have other places we want to go. And those are all things to take inside, you know, we keep in mind our staff doesn't like working with their staff, whether it's, you know, decision making, whatever it is, they take forever, they forget what they do, they blame us, you know, these are all kinds of things to consideration when you're evaluating client quality.
Absolutely. And it kind of goes back to your point earlier about being able to understand the finances of your client, because this helps you structure and negotiate your fees and understand when there might be issues and pain points. Or, you know, I often use the example of working with developers. And you need to understand how your developers are financing their projects, because that's going to affect how they're going to be paying you. And there's opportunity in that, because we've seen some of our clients here at BOA, they've started to structure their deals where they, you know, they can have their, if the client, if they're going to be on a sort of flat rate billing type of thing with the developer, it's one price. But if the developer wants them to enter into a paid when get paid, well, then the fees go up because the architect is taking on more risk to enter into that kind of contract. But there's opportunity there, to start being creative with how your fees are structured. But you need to understand, like you say, you need to understand the financial movements of your clients.
No, and you said something else, Ryan, that reminds me of something equally important. It comes back to why the receivables tracking is important. What I always get concerned about, and I just saw this with a client the other day, particularly when you're working with a new client and you have a long-term project and you're 3 or 4 months or 3 or 4 invoices into the project, you've maybe billed, you know, it could be as much as 30, 40% of the total project fee to date, and you haven't been paid yet. So that always is something to keep an eye on with new clients. Be on top of the collections from the beginning, because you can find out you're 6 months in, you've accumulated, or if you know the term, spent, you know, a significant portion of the fee, and you've yet to receive $1 in payment. That's frankly scares me to death, particularly if you're not familiar with the detailed finances of that client. Because yeah. Again, we're doing the work. You want clients that treat us and the team with respect, and paying the bill is certainly to me one of those, you know, signs of respect. And I think to the extent that more and more client organizations have people with their financial team working remotely, this checking, I want to confirm you have received the bill, is an important thing to be thinking about somewhere in that 45, 50 day range. I strongly recommend that, because more than ever, there's this opportunity, oh, I didn't get that. Now, you know, sometimes that happens, you know, the mail, if you're sending things to the traditional mail, they've had their challenges as well. But as you also know, for people that like to drag their feet, it's a convenient excuse to say, I didn't get the invoice. So
yeah, absolutely. And brilliant. I think that's a perfect place to
And that's an easy thing for a project manager to do, to say, hey, I've just asked to check that you got the invoice. So to have the PMs do that, or the senior lead do that on the 45, that's an easy ask. You're not asking, are we getting paid? You're just saying, please confirm you have the bill. And then, you know, between us, I'll call you back next week and ask you when you're going to pay it. But I think that's because that's always, as you know, the front piece. No one's going to pay something that they can't confirm they have the invoice for.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, you know, we're not banks. We're not banks for our clients. Exactly. And this is the thing. I mean, again, I speak to some architects, right, and they're, you know, they're 6 months out getting paid, and it's enormous amounts,
right,
and they feel bad because it's the biggest client that they've got in the portfolio, and they don't want to rock the boat. But this is one of the things that can cause the most damage into a company.
And I think also, don't be reluctant, pending any professional sort of ethics guidelines or legal situation that doesn't give you this position, don't be reluctant to say, hey, I'm not giving you X, whether it's an updated drawing or even a certificate of occupancy. Again, I'm not trying to tell you to do anything that your local area might have a legal provision against. Don't be squeamish about, hey, enough, you need to settle up with me and then I'll give you the rest of it. Because sometimes it comes to that, and you, hopefully it doesn't, but you know, you need to kind of keep an eye out for when that kind of, you know, if you know the good cop, bad cop kind of thing, you need to be heavy on the bad cop part of it.
Well, we had a client recently. Did I tell you the story? One of our clients' unpaid invoice really got to the end of their tether, if you like, with this client. They'd taken one of the clients to court. They'd won the small claims in the court. I know in the US, if you win a small claims court order against another business for an unpaid invoice, that there's a mechanism in place, yes, which means that you can actually get the money from the bank directly.
Right.
However, it's not necessarily a straightforward mechanism,
right,
to actually employ. But they, you know, they actually went, the client actually went down to the, I think it was a bakery that hadn't paid unpaid invoice, and said, pay me now. Otherwise I'm going to start, you know, talking to your clients, your customers in this shop right now about what kind of business you are. The client refused. We haven't got your money. This had been going on for a long, long period of time, and that the architect started talking with the customers, and they were like, okay, stop. Here's your check. Get out.
Yeah, no, it's unfortunate when you have to take that extreme, but some people put themselves in the predicament of that's what has to happen. So,
yeah, absolutely. Brilliant. Well, that's the perfect place for us to conclude, Hugh. Thank you very much. Deep dive whirlwind tour of the essential financial key performance indicators metrics that every practice should be looking at.
Okay, great. Thank you, Ryan. It's been a pleasure.
And that's a wrap. And don't forget, if you want to access your free training to learn how to structure your firm or practice for freedom, fulfillment, and profit, please visit smartpracticemethod.com. Or if you'd like to speak to one of our advisors directly, follow the link in the information. The views expressed on this show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment except to help you be unstoppable.